I respect him dearly. We've had decent discussions in the park in the past. As I mentioned earlier, many times, that there is a lot of hate and misconceptions in the world about each other. And one of the reasons I come to the park is to have decent intellectual discussions, respectfully, so that the world can see that there are people who have the ability and the acumen to have decent discussions, to be able to teach people by indulging with each other respectfully. And I have found with Sayyid Ali that I can do that. And he feels the same about me. I abstain from insulting to the best of my ability, although I'm human. Sometimes I get passionate and things can come out of my mouth, which I don't mean. But mostly, I try my best to have a respectful demeanor and a respectful approach towards the Shia, as well as the Christians, as well as the Jewish people who visit here. Although the Shias are Muslims, I believe generally the masses are Muslims, right? And we can demonstrate that we can collectively come together, we can disagree severely with each other, but we can be respectful.
Absolutely.
And our audiences, our brothers and sisters, whether they are Shia or Sunni, they have the right to be able to hear both sides respectfully. There are many haters out there. There are many so-called scholars out there or so-called preachers out there who peddle a lot of hate against each other from both sides, yeah. From the Sunni side and from the Shia side, right? And they may have followers because some people like entertainment. They like controversy. They like hate. They like, harshness. We don't agree with that in the park. I'm sure Sayyid Ali doesn't agree with that,
absolutely.
Right? So we have disagreed in the park. You know, we have. I mean, do you want to...
No, I mean, as I was mentioning to you earlier, many brothers have approached me from the Shia and Sunni community who say that they really enjoy our discussions because, as you said, we always keep it respectful. At times, with discussions, it can get heated.
Yes.
But there's still mutual love. The moment we stop discussing, that's it. We see each other as, you know, brothers. We're brothers. And the whole Mustad Umar, to some extent, it's one big family. And as you mentioned before, you know, we should never let, you know, people from outside use our differences to further divide us.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there are people here with agendas, no doubt. This is an open place. People come in. All sorts of Tom, Dicks and Harrys are walking in. We don't know who is who here. We have no idea. You know, there may be people coming here for years and you don't know what they're up to in their life otherwise,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
But as far as we are concerned, myself, speaking for myself, yeah. I'm only here to educate, right? And, you know, believe me, Brother Ali,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
I have received bad feedback from Sunnis.
Right.
They're saying you're being too kind to the Shia.
Right, wow.
Yeah, absolutely. So sometimes I receive this feedback that why are you being so kind to them? Why are you being so soft with them? Why are you not attacking them? Why are you not making takfir on them? Why are you not calling them kuffar, right. For example, like that? I do receive feedback like that, right? And I'm pretty sure from the other side, the same thing is happening. A lot of the Shias are commenting online on videos that these guys, they don't know nothing. They are just there to, you know.
You will always get this online hate, and this unfortunately Muslims are guilty of.
Yeah.
Even hopefully with this video now, these videos, This whole thing, episode, is being recorded on different video platforms. Unfortunately, yes, when it comes to ethics, we shouldn't forget, you know, who we follow. We follow the Prophet and peace and blessings be upon him, who was the best of role models.
Yes.
And he attracted people towards Islam through his ethics, through his discussions, through his dialogues, through the way he treated people.
Yeah.
At times, he even never told people that he was a Muslim, and they became a Muslim just based on the way he conducted himself. So, you know, as you said, if you have got people like that from your community, be it from the Shia community or even the Sunni community, these people, they lack basic ethics in terms of how to discuss with people and attract people and call people to the message of Islam.
And I think this is why it's our job to teach our audiences how to behave. If they're not behaving already,
yeah.
If they're not behaving themselves,
yeah.
We need to teach them how...
Definitely.
Okay.
Because you've got a lot of people who
yeah.
are from non-Muslim backgrounds. When
yeah.
they come and they look at these videos,
yeah.
they look at some of these comments made by people.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's quite repulsive that, you know, yeah. if I was a non-Muslim person who goes to a Muslim platform to see, you know, what Muslims have got to say, regardless of whatever the topic is, and then you got people swearing, doing takfir on the opposite sex, what will they do? It will just create further confusion. Yes, you know, we can have these differences, no problem. Discuss them in an intellectual manner, and, you know, let the audience decide. At the end of the day, you know, making, you know, debating is not everything. You can be an atheist and be a good debater.
Yes.
You know, you've got people like Sam Harris, let's be realistic. He's an intellectual person to some extent. Yes. But does it mean that what Sam Harris calls towards is the truth? No, it doesn't. So, you know, never think that, you know, you have debates. Sometimes people do well, sometimes people don't do well. It's just simple as that. Do you not agree?
Absolutely. 100%. And those people out there who are commenting unpleasant things, who are commenting vicious, vile, you know, things online, on videos, I want to reiterate, please stop doing that.
It's disgusting.
It doesn't help. Yeah. If you have nothing positive to say, then abstain. The Prophet ﷺ said that if you have nothing good to say, then silence is best. And I'm paraphrasing the Prophet ﷺ, his words. So, brothers and sisters, we have been taught by our Prophet, we have to demonstrate that behavior, that we, if we have nothing positive to say, abstain. Okay, if you want to take part in the discussion, then post something that people can actually read and learn from. And someone else will come along and post a rebuttal, for that matter, right? People will come and have a discussion in the comments. The comments are there to educate people, not to be vile and be vulgar, right? Whether you are Muslim or non-Muslim, whoever you may be, right? There are absolutely disgusting people out there. I've seen some vile comments, you know, from all sides, from all corners. And it's, sometimes I feel, are these people okay? We are living in a very dangerous world if these people are normal.
Yeah, all it does, it incites sectarianism,
yeah.
and incites hatred, you know, against the opposing faction, you know. You know, you've got many non-Muslim people here who criticize the Holy Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him. You know, they swear, insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But, you know, the Muslims generally, you know, if you're not tolerant of that, if you're not tolerant of people having a difference of opinion to you in Speaker's Corner, then the truth is you shouldn't be here.
No, we don't ever tolerate that. What you do is you walk away from such people.
Yeah.
You don't stand there and listen to insults against the Prophet ﷺ. We cannot possibly tolerate people insulting the Prophet in... You have the freedom to walk away. Just walk away. Exactly. Don't be violent. Don't be repulsive. Don't lose your ethics and morality over someone barking at the Prophet ﷺ. Let them bark. There are people throughout centuries, and it hasn't stopped the influx of people coming into Islam.
Exactly.
There are hundreds of millions of people coming to Islam. There are 2 billion followers of this man called Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They send salawat upon him in every single prayer.
Exactly.
They praise him in every single prayer 5 times a day. We love him so much that we have to praise him every single day for what he has done for us.
Exactly.
So people barking at him, people insulting him, people being repulsive towards him, it doesn't stop his work.
Absolutely.
Right? So you don't have to waste yourself against someone like that. Just walk away. Right. We don't have to tolerate it.
Exactly.
So because when you're standing there and smiling at someone like that, you're tolerating it. You don't have to tolerate it. Just walk away.
Exactly.
Just walk away.
Yeah, okay. I think that's a pretty short, to the point message. And, you know, I saw Brother Adnan, and, you know, we were just discussing how generally people, they enjoy our discussions for this very reason, that we maintain this akhlaq and adab respect.
And we will continue to do so. 100%. Yeah.
And inshallah, we will have other fruitful conversations in the future.
Absolutely, inshallah. And people can see our human side. You see, a lot of the time, people around the world are watching videos coming from Iraq, from Syria, from Yemen, from Pakistan. For example, if a bomb went off somewhere, people start to say these Shias or these Sunnis, these Shias or these Sunnis. No, that's not the case. It's these terrorists from both sides. It's these terrorists from both sides. They need to be condemned. It's not the Shias and Sunnis. Because there are Shias and Sunnis going around. They're doing the thing. They're law-abiding citizens, and they want to know the truth.
Yeah.
There are people out there, they want to know the truth. So we can come together and demonstrate that there are Shias and Sunnis who can stand together
Absolutely.
As brothers in humanity,
Absolutely.
Not necessarily in faith, because I don't believe in what Sayyid Ali believes in. He does not believe in what I believe in, right? We don't have to be on the same page when it comes to faith and our belief.
But we respect those differences.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Or as far apart as they are, yeah. Okay, we respect each other's view.
Yeah.
We don't agree with these views,
yeah.
But we respect them.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Now that we have said that, is there anything you want to talk about? Very quickly, we can have a quick discussion.
Often you see a lot of Christian missionaries citing Sayyid Bukhari.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Do you have any doubts in any traditions within these two works? Or do you generally accept them to be authentic?
Absolutely. We accept every single Musnad report in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim.
So how do you reconcile with the contradictions, for example?
For example,
the creation of everything within a 7-day period. So there's
right.
a tradition
right.
in say Muslim
yeah.
That says that, you know, I believe it's narrated by Abu Huraira.
Yeah.
Some of the scholars have criticized it. They said that they believe this could be an Israeli art, right?
Okay.
As a prime.
I know the report you're talking about. It's in Sahih Muslim. It's
yeah.
in Sahih Muslim.
So if you're saying,
Sheikh Albani has written extensively
yeah. Yeah.
on it.
Bin Baz has even commented.
Yes.
He said that this is problematic tradition because
it's not problematic. Okay. If you look at it, it's okay. complementary because a lot of this when you see contradiction is something that directly contradicts information given in one place and
right.
then you find completely different information in another place, for example.
Right.
Okay, for example, in the gospel records on crucifixion, right. just
the
on the matter,
stories,
story is the same.
Right.
The details are far apart from each other.
Yeah.
One story is saying that the door of the tomb was open.
Mm.
And I was like, no, it was closed.
Right.
This is a contradiction,
right.
Okay? But
you know why I'm asking? The only reason I'm asking is because I think Brother Muhammad Hijab was actually asked regarding this particular narration.
Yeah.
And he disregarded it. So this is why I'm asking you that, is your position is that you deep...
My position is every single authentic report, which is Sahih
basically
and Muslim...
Basically, Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, is
okay.
Sahih.
Let me state my position.
Right.
I believe every single authentic report... Whether it's in Bukhari or in Tibrani or Mu'jam al-Kabir of Sunan al-Bayhaqi
or
something, wherever it may be, if it has been authenticated
right.
by the Muhaddithin,
right.
okay, then it cannot possibly contradict the Quran or another report,
right.
unless it is a case of abrogation.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically everything Bukhari and Muslim is deemed Sahih.
Yes.
Your understanding.
Unless it has been there's no contradiction.
Right.
Unless it has been abrogated. Okay.
So what about the traditions that perhaps may I know I gave you an example about the 7 days.
Yeah.
But what if there are other reports within Bukhari and Muslim which contradict each other?
Yeah.
You saying there's not?
None.
There's none. Okay.
None. I'm here almost every Sunday when I'm in the country.
Problem.
Bring the reports, and we will. I'm one of those people you will find open, never running away from our faith, or from our theology, from shying away from discussing these topics.
Do you
inshallah.
Find that some people do disregard some reports in Bukhari and Muslim?
They are a fringe.
Right.
For example, Sheikh Albani.
Right.
When I say fringe, those opinions are fringe opinions, Shah's opinions. For example, in Sheikh Albani, he said one or two reports are questionable in Bukhari because of the isnad.
Right.
Not because of the matan, because of the isnad. Okay, there is a problem in the chain.
Yeah.
But their opinions have been disregarded
There is one tradition I recall where he discusses one of the wives of the Holy Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him. And he says that she passed away after the death of the Holy Prophet. But then again, I don't have the passage.
Yeah, bring the reports.
Yeah,
bring the reports.
Yeah.
And don't forget.
Yeah. So, one question here.
Yeah.
I know you asked a couple of questions here.
Yeah, yeah.
So in terms of those reports where you see the disputes between the companions and members of the Ahl al-Bayt, right? And often you see Shias and Sunnis quoting these traditions and discussing them.
In isolation.
Yeah.
Many times, yes.
Okay, so
yes.
Is the isolated reports within Bukhari and Muslim also deemed authentic or not?
Absolutely. Oh, because look.
So then how do you reconcile that then?
Okay,
for example, Fatima dying angry with Abu Bakr and these traditions that talk about Maul Ali, criticizing the
You see, when we look at our history and our literature, we look at it holistically. Okay, we don't take reports in isolation like some of our Shia brothers do.
Right.
What they do is they take reports in isolation.
Right.
They ignore the greater context.
But we can say the same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can.
Yeah,
you can.
Yeah.
And we can argue back how we are not taking reports in isolation.
Okay.
For example, that's another matter.
Yeah,
when it comes to Shias, it's another matter.
Okay.
Okay. Now we are talking about Bukhari. For example, when you take a report in isolation and say, "Look at this report," okay, this report, and you may be right. For example, I'll give you a classic example some Shia brothers have used it in the park, right? It's a report in Bukhari, and Bukhari is munfarid in using that particular wording, amazingly. No other muhaddith used that particular wording for this report. The Prophet ﷺ pointed to the house of Aisha and said, وَأَشَارَ إِلَىٰ حُجْرَتِهِ وَقَالْ الْفِتْنَةُ هَا هُنَا الْفِتْنَةُ هَا هُنَا Allahu Akbar. Now, if you take this report in isolation, any Sunni would be shaken. You know, as they said, the rug would be pulled off your feet. So you would be thinking, Subhanallah, the Prophet is actually saying Aisha is fitna. Okay? Now, if you took that report in isolation, you would definitely walk out with that particular conclusion. But we don't take it in isolation. Yeah. We go to Sahih Muslim, Kitab al-Fitn. We go to, for example, Sahih ibn Khuzaima. We go to all other reports in this regard. They complement each other. Okay. Because the Prophet made this statement in different places in front of different people. And when you look at those statements, what comes to light, he was pointing towards Iraq. وَأَشَارَ إِلَى الْمَشْرِكِ Another report in Sahih Muslim in Kitab al-Fitn, وَأَشَارَ إِلَى الْمَشْرِكِ Where is Mashrik? From the member of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? Mashrik is the hujra of Aisha radiallahu anha. Right. So how do we know the Prophet couldn't be possibly saying that it is Aisha? Because he was buried there. The Prophet himself was buried in that very place. How can he be saying fitna is there? Then that means the Prophet himself is the fitna, a'udhu billah. He was living there himself. The Prophet himself was living there. So, looking at the greater context, we correct our Shia brothers respectfully that you do not take reports in isolation.
Okay.
Likewise, when it comes to the relationship between Ahlul Bayt and the Sahaba, we don't take reports in isolation that Ali said this to Muawiyah, Muawiyah said this about Ali, No, we look at the greater context.
Right.
We take everything into consideration and then we assess the situation. Okay. This is how we Sunnis end up with a different belief from the Shias.
Okay, so okay, so on a point note then, so you're saying you don't look at isolated reports, rather you look at all the traditions related to that subject matter to make a conclusion.
Yeah.
So what if these traditions go against the two primary sources, Bukhari and Muslim? Is preference given to Bukhari and Muslim over those traditions?
No, we look at the authenticity. Well, do you see?
So do you get my point, what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, of course.
So if there's reports out of Bukhari and Muslim which are Sahih,
okay, if
they go against the tradition of Bukhari,
if they are Sahih, it is impossible for them to go against Bukhari.
Bukhari Muslim.
Yeah, impossible. Okay. If they are Sahih, if they are Hasan, Hasan Gharib, Hasan li dhatihi or Hasan li ghairihi.
Okay,
yeah, this is that's a complete. This is where the gray area comes in.
Okay,
but if they have been deemed Sahih, authentic, okay, then it is impossible for them to contradict Bukhari and Muslim.
Okay,
this is my challenge.
Okay. Okay, so then, you know, I mentioned this report to you before, that the Holy Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, his daughter Sayyidah Fatima Salaam Alayha, she died angry with Abu Bakr, according to the hadith which is mentioned in Bukhari, right? So now, how do you reconcile that with other reports which you have read? Because that tradition says that she stopped speaking to him.
Yes.
She died angry with him.
Yes.
It actually says that.
Okay.
Right? I'm not making up.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sure you read it yourself.
Okay.
So how do you reconcile that tradition?
Okay. First of all, let's look at the report in Arabic. If the words are angry, okay.
Yep.
I don't remember the words.
Yeah.
I do know the report you're talking about.
Yeah.
But there are other reports, for example, that Fatima radiallahu anha, she made up with Abu Bakr.
Yeah.
These reports, you can find them in Imam Suyuti's Tariq al-Khulafa, and they are authentic. Okay.
Yeah.
That Abu Bakr went to the door of Fatima when he heard that she's upset. She's upset. He went to the door and he said, I will not leave until the daughter of Rasulullah is pleased with me.
Okay.
Because he gave his reasons. That the reason why I cannot give you Fadak, is because the Prophet kept it that way. And amazingly, how do we argue our case? You see, again, holistically, looking at all the reports in this regard, and all the facts in this regard, okay? Without looking at Abu Bakr in isolation, and ignoring Ali, Hassan, and the rest of the Ahlul Bayt, what they did with Ali was...
So can I just ask you an important
question? Final point. Yep. Ali was Khalifa for 4 years, albeit in Iraq. Albeit in Iraq, right? His hub was Iraq, okay? But he had power over Medina.
Right.
Medina was governed by his governor.
Yep.
He did not take Fadak. When he had the power to do so. So Ali kept the situation, the position of Fadak, just like Abu Bakr. Yep. And then to complete the report, Fatima, she said, I am pleased with him. Okay. She told Ali that I am pleased with him. Tell Abu Bakr to now he can be in comfort. I am pleased with it. Okay. So we have reports like that. So now,
okay, can I just comment on that report now?
Yeah, yeah.
See, it's interesting because Brother Adnan mentioned that they do have these reports that says that Abu Bakr and Umar went to Sayyidah Fatima As-Salamu Alayha to try to make her pleased with them. So we must agree in one thing. There was a point where she was displeased.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, yes. She
That's
was. She was.
Point to note, right?
Yes.
So now what's interesting is that if you actually go back to this particular narration, and by all means, you can check into this, and the viewers, this is being recorded as well, you'll notice that the particular individual who's actually narrated that report, he wasn't an eyewitness to the incident. He actually came much later. And many of the scholars actually rejected his isolated particular narrations, as in where he's narrated that hadith.
If you bring the details, we can discuss it. But then that can be said about the Bukhari report. Because Fatima never met another non-mahram man. We know that, right? So how did this Bukhari narrator know that Fatima was upset? Because he was hearing the news from a third party. Okay? So that can be argued about the Bukhari report as well. If we go like this...
So now then it goes back to the point that you do have these reports. They do exist in the book.
Absolutely.
And obviously, if you deem these reports to be authentic...
Yes.
Then the question arises in terms of how they heard it. That will open a whole debate as in terms of, well, okay, then we might as well just disregard that report. Do you get my point as well?
Yeah, 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 but we don't. Well, what we do is we don't look at them in isolation. We first of all,
I'll give you like a simple example now, yeah? Why is it that we do not know where Sayyidah Fatima As-Salamu Alayha is even buried? Why is it such
We don't know. We know the Ahata.
As in the area,
the Khitta. We know the Khitta.
We don't know the spot. We don't know the spot.
No, we don't.
So this is another something interesting to us. But what I'm going to do...
Do we know where Ali is buried? Radiallahu anhu.
Okay, so according to our reports, it was pointed out during the time of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, where he actually pointed to that spot and said, this is where my great-great-great-great...
Do we know where Imam Hassan is... Imam Hussain is buried?
According to us, we do have those locations. Of course, we cannot be certain
the Shias of Kufa, they loved him so much... Right. As they claimed, even having killed him, they claimed that they love him. They cried for him, right? They don't know where his grave is.
Okay, so now...
There's no certainty. So this can be thrown back at the Shia brothers as well. Yeah. That if you are... The reason why Fatima radiallahu anha is grave is... You see, when you go to Al-Baqi, it is not out of malicious planning that her grave was lost. No. It's been 1,400 years. Okay, we don't even know the graves of prophets. We don't know where Ibrahim is buried, where Musa is buried, where Isa alayhi salam hasn't died. So for example, Dawood or Suleiman, we don't have their graves, right? So that in itself doesn't prove anything, right?
Okay.
That doesn't reduce our love for Fatima radiallahu anha.
So viewers, do you know what? I apologize because I'm actually quite rushed for time.
Okay.
And it was a fruitful conversation with Brother Adnan. Hmm. Definitely, Brother Adnan, I actually had a debate with another brother on this particular topic.
Okay.
And the viewers can always go back to whatever platform. What's your platform? SC Dawa and...
SC Dawa or all these...
I'm going to leave...
No, these are not my platform. Okay. Let me clarify. Okay. None of these cameramen are my cameramen.
Okay.
Okay, because... Recently, I don't know if you know about this fiasco. So I'm not responsible for any individual.
My platform
is my YouTube channel.
No problem.
Okay, my YouTube channel.
So what I'm going to do is on Bayt al-Ghadir, I will put my debate up on whether or not Sayyidah Fatima did die angry with Abu Bakr and Umar. But definitely, Brother Adnan, I'm going to send you the link.
Okay.
I want you to watch the debate and also series and viewers as well, and you make a conclusion, inshallah.
Okay. And why don't we have discussions?
A sit down discussion.
I mean, I prefer the park because... People really enjoy the discussions in the park because they are on the spot. They are, how can I put it?
We'll get the beach seats out next time.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I really, I'm quite nostalgic. I'm quite nostalgic about those situations. So let's do that, inshallah. Thank you so much for your time. Nice to meet you again. And you're always welcome to talk to me. Okay, no worries. Assalamu alaikum. Okay.